Let's start talking about classification. This means that we're going into supervised learning, where we have an output and a set of inputs. In particular, when we talk about classification, we're talking about a categorical output, where Y, the categorical output, is either a group or a class, which means that we're talking about a membership for each record. So, for instance, we can use the notation C1, C2, etc. to denote the different possible classes of a record. Our predictors, just like in normal regression, can be numerical or categorical or a combination of both. But what's special about classification is, again, that the output has categories. So, what I want you to be able to do after we finish talking about classification, and there are going to be lots of different classification methods, also known as classifiers, is not just to be able to run things mechanically, but to understand more carefully, first of all, when do I see a classification task? The ability to look at a business problem and translate it into a classification task is very difficult. And that's really where data mining shines, when you're able to identify a very useful classification task that can be tackled with your data. Secondly, I want you to be familiar with several classic applications of classification so that, first of all, you can try and implement those in your job in the future. And from there, of course, once you're familiar with the standard and classical examples, you want to move and be creative. So thinking about what are other applications is going to be crucial. Nextly, we're going to be looking at a bunch of different classifiers, but a major commonality across all of these different methods is that we need to know how to evaluate their performance. And we already talked a little bit about performance evaluation earlier on. We're going to get deeper into performance evaluation very soon. That is critical, more critical than choosing a particular classifier. Finally, I am going to introduce to you a bunch of popular classifiers or classification techniques so that you're familiar with the lingo, so that you understand what are the advantages and disadvantages of different methods, and what are possibilities for deploying classification. In our book, and in particular in this course, let me talk about a few of the methods that we'll be using. So you can see the highlighted column here called classification, or categorical Y, and I split it into numerical predictors. So this is supervised learning with numerical predictors. And below we have categorical predictors. If our predictors are numerical, we'll see logistic regression can work. K-nearest neighbors is another method. And the unhighlighted method, discriminant analysis, is also described in the book. When our predictors are strictly categorical, then we can use classification trees. Again, logistic regression works there too. In fact, logistic regression is a cousin of linear regression and will work whether your predictors are numerical, categorical, or mixed. And we'll also look at the very neat technique called naive Bayes. There's another technique described in the book called neural nets, which we won't cover in this course, but again, that is very useful for categorical predictors. So why do we even want to classify? So think about it this way. Why do we use linear regression? We talked about two very different but useful goals of using linear regression. We talked about descriptive or explanatory goals, and we talked about predictive goals. In the explanatory scenario, we're trying to retrospectively understand a relationship between an output and a set of inputs. In the predictive mode, we're trying to predict a set of new records using that linear regression model. This is the same idea underlying classification, except we're going to use slightly different terms. Explaining in the classification world is called profiling. That's because if we have two groups or two classes, we're trying to profile what are the inputs that separate the two types of classes. The term prediction is translated into classification. So when people say we're classifying, they usually mean that they're talking about predicting new records or predicting the class of new records. Let's look at just a few examples. Suppose that we're looking at a call center where we have a bunch of data on customer demographics, information on customer calls, and billing history. Then I can ask myself an explanatory question such as, what factors affect customer satisfaction? What would be goals? Remember, such a data analytic question, what factors affect customer satisfaction, is coming from a bigger business goal. Well, the purpose might be that we're trying to develop retention strategies, or maybe acquisition strategies. Perhaps we're even trying to implement some policy changes, and we want to see what needs to be changed. So this is an explanatory task, what I call profiling, where we might try and compare the leavers and the stayers. We'll look at the people who remain with a company, say, for 6 months, compared to those who left within 6 months. We can compare their demographics, we can compare their customer calls, we can compare their billing history, and try and figure out which of these factors separate them. Again, this is profiling because we're interested in explaining a relationship. Can we take the same data set and try to think of a classification goal? In other words, now I don't care about explaining the relationship between, say, retention and different factors, but if I'm trying to predict it. Let's say we're using the exact same data. These are the same data that we had in the explanatory task. Try and think of a classification goal that would be useful to a call center. Now let's look at an example that's a classic classifying case. And that is, for instance, direct marketing. When you receive offers such as for credit cards, that usually has behind the scenes some classification going on, if it's a smart company. And the reason is that it's quite expensive to send out these mailers. It can be expensive in terms of mailing it out, or it can be expensive in wasting the customer's attention or even irritating them when they're not going to be interested in that offer. So targeting the right customers, meaning the ones who are most likely to accept the offer, is a very common application. In this case, our Y variable is whether they accept the offer or not. And we did talk about some controversial examples of classification. We talked about American Express using information about customers to make all kinds of decisions. We also talked about other classic examples, such as determining whether to give a loan. So the Y variable is, should we give the loan? Is the person going to default, or is the person actually going to return the money on time? And then again, we have a bunch of predictors, and we're trying to predict what's going to happen in the future. This takes me to the example down here on the left, which we discussed very briefly in one of the earlier sessions. Let's look again at this article from 2009 describing quite an unusual classification example. Let me read the article. Researchers from the Children's Hospital Boston sifted through an anonymized database of over 500,000 EMR patient records to develop a mathematical model that shows a decent ability to detect cases of domestic abuse. The variables associated with abuse, such as higher number of annual visits, mental health diagnosis, and visits for injury, were used to create a predictive model, which was tested on the remaining third of the patients. Let me stop here for a minute. Are you identifying that this is a classification task? If so, what is that output variable that is categorical, that has classes? What are we measuring? We're measuring whether a person who walks into the EMR is a victim of domestic abuse or not, which means that our data set needs to include a label that tells me whether indeed each one of these people was a victim of domestic abuse or not. In order to predict into the future, we have to learn. In order to learn, we need data with these labels on the Y variable. Notice another hint here that we're talking about a predictive task, a classification task, rather than profiling. You might have noticed the last sentence, tested on the remaining third of the patients. This is the usual holdout concept. And of course, here, if we want to know how well this algorithm is going to work on future patients, this is the way to evaluate performance. Now look at some of the results that they discovered. Alcoholism, poisoning, and injuries from external causes were more predictive of abuse in women than in men, while psychosis, affective disorders, and other mental conditions were more predictive in men than in women. Here's an interesting point. The algorithms that they are using here are able to identify which of the inputs is more predictive of the outputs. That is not always the case with classifiers, meaning classification methods. Some methods are more black box, meaning that they might produce great predictions, but we don't really understand which ones of the predictors are contributing more to the predictions. Here they're using predictive models, but ones that are less black boxy, ones that are more interpretable. We've already seen linear regression, and that is a very interpretable method because we can see the weights and we can see how different inputs affect the output. Finally, note that the last paragraph talks about a visualization or some kind of a dashboard that helps alert doctors to some kinds of abuse. So it's not sufficient to build the predictive algorithm itself. You also have to think about deployment. Who will be using it? How will they be using it? How will they be abusing your solution? And that is a very, very important of communicating and implementing the system. So now that we've seen how a very interesting data set is used for predicting abuse, predicting whether the person is really a victim of abuse, can you think of using the same data set for a profiling goal? And I've just re-quoted what were the main variables that they measured. Think about it and see if you can come up with a useful business application, or maybe a medical application, or maybe some other type of application that gives benefit.